I was ready to, and you said you're in the lot.
All right. Let me get the official language here. Good morning, y'all.
That's the official language.
Thank you for giving me grief. Appreciate that.
Only because we love you.
Call this meeting to order of the Tourist Development Council, April 13th. My watch is rerouting. Okay, Jackie's not here.
Nope.
Who wants to give the invocation? You're here.
Mr. Mankey.
I thought you were gone today.
Oh, no, yes, I did end up being able to come. They rescheduled that interview, so we're good to go.
Oh, awesome. Okay, so who wants to give the invocation?
All right.
Anyone?
Sure.
Yeah. Prepare yourself in the manner in which you're accustomed. Thank you, O Lord, for the opportunity to serve the citizens of Citrus County and help us to make wise decisions. We thank you for our first responders, our elected leaders, and certainly all the volunteers that help out to make the community grow and flourish. Thank you.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, roll call, please.
Roll call. So present today, we have Chair Holly Davis, Vice Chair Mike Ingalls, Dr. Paresh Desai, Michael Mankey, Mike Shoemaker, Gene McGee, and Ashton Strock. And absent are Cindy Guy and Jackie Heppner, and we do have a quorum.
Awesome. Okay, looking for a motion to approve the agenda?
So moved.
Second.
All right. Any public comment?
Yeah.
Board comment? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes, or any opposed? Motion passes unanimously. Okay, need to approve the minutes and a meeting and excused absences. Looking for a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Any public comment? Any board comment? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries unanimously. All right, open to the public. Anyone?
Who's on here to make those motions?
Leslie, have
you? You are the public.
Just got an opinion.
Welcome
about
public.
Something.
Okay, presentations on to Madden.
All right. Yeah. So each quarterly we have updates from Madden, and this time we've brought forward some interesting possible special project options. They'll give you a rundown of some of the successes we've had lately, and then we'll go into that. We're thankful to have TJ Fletcher live and in person as our account manager.
Awesome.
And then on the screen you can see yesterday's birthday boy, Brett Gordon, John Bridges, and Jen O'Connor. So from scattered around the country. So. At this point, I'll turn it over to TJ and we'll go into the presentation.
And right. Welcome, and my apologies again for being late.
Hey, no worries. Thank you so much for having us today. Well, we're super excited to be here. As John said, I've got some colleagues that will be tag-teaming this presentation. My name is TJ Fletcher. I'm the Director of Destination Strategy, and I've been with Madden for 7 years, and I lead accounts all across the Southeast. So I was actually just up here a couple of weeks ago when we were filming a WFLA segment in Homosassa, so it's always a good opportunity to be live and in person and in market, and I really appreciate the opportunity. Today, some of the things that we're going to go over, we're going to review some industry trends, what's happening in the travel space in general. We're going to talk specifically about some destination marketing intelligence insights with the Madden Voyage platform. We're going to go over some media updates, and then we're going to talk about some new opportunities that John mentioned as well for some special project funding. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Brett, who is going to talk about some of the industry trends.
Sure. Thanks, TJ. So I'll just hit a couple of things. This is some data just at the national level from U.S. travel and destination analysts. Not going to hit each of these, but we continue to see strong demand, especially within the state. All the surveys coming back, you're starting to see concerns around fuel prices and inflation and things like that. For most of our partners, we're not seeing that having an immediate impact yet. They're concerned, but they're still coming. But a lot of our partners feel a lot like you guys, where we're focused in on closer in markets, mainly focused in drive radius. As we continue to keep an eye on that, we will potentially be thinking about pulling back on the distance out that we're marketing if fuel prices continue to stay high in the summer. But I think TJ is going to hit on that a bit later in the presentation, but just certainly something that we're watching closely. But with all those factors out there, demand continues to be strong and continues to increase. And Jen, if you go to the next slide, especially in Florida, Florida continue, and I'm sure you guys know well, we continue to be strong. It seems pretty consistent across most destinations in the state that we've gone back to and starting to exceed 2019 numbers. But that's continued to be carried by domestic. We were up in DC last week and meeting with a few of the congressmen and senators and continue to push support for legislation to open up international. International per visit Florida is still only at about 40% of what it was in 2019. And mainly with the inbound departure test, COVID requirement continues to be a barrier. So we're hoping to see that lifted soon. And it seemed like we had some good support from some of the legislators up there. So just putting that out there, while there are some challenges, if we do and hopefully do see that international barrier being opened up very soon, there's a whole lot of international demand that's going to be coming into the state, and something that we'll need to make sure we keep an eye on, make sure that the Citrus County message is in front of those as that comes up. So all in all, a little bit of headwind from the economy, inflation and fuel, but continue to be very bullish and strong with visitation to the state and especially to Citrus County. So TJ, I'll kick to you and you can hit some specific insights from our Voyage platform.
Actually, I'll jump in here, Brett. Yeah, don't worry about it. But yeah, we wanted to share with you guys some of the really cool stuff and some of the neat data that we can get from Voyage platform, specifically being able to do a lot of really cool lodging insights that are comparing, you know, many years in the past. And so it was great to be able to see that this fiscal year, looking from October to February, we had a total of 11,000 visitors. And this is just kind of a sample size. This isn't all the visitors that came to the destination. But that, you know, on average, they stayed over 3 days, which we know, you know, kind of impacts that overall revenue for the destination. What's really also great to see is that, I mean, what you can see kind of in the graph there is where kind of, you know, pre-pandemic numbers looked like. You see that dip in FY21, and then you see the recovery that we've seen in the beginning of FY22, where we're now exceeding or meeting each month for those occupancy rates as we keep going through. So it's really fantastic to see. We love to see that kind of recovery, those recovery numbers. And you know, we just continue to monitor this stuff. And on the next slide, you'll kind of see how we start to correlate with this data, what our media is doing and where that correlation of the media to the actual, you know, arrivals of the destination. So, you know, we observed over 280,000 clicks, 21 million impressions, you know, 1.5 million video views for this fiscal year. But, you know, those are great big numbers. But what we really want to do is let's stack that next to what are those arrivals that we measured? And do we see, you know, kind of marked improvement? Do we see increases? And you can kind of see this like monthly delay, right? So as you look at this graph here, you can kind of see where we have steady impression numbers. We see a nice big push there at the end of December, beginning of January. And then, you know, a couple 30 to 45 days later, we see this nice spike of arrivals that show up in February. And so you can kind of be able to map, is our media working? And how is it affecting our actual, you know, kind of ROI in terms of arrivals to the destination? So really fantastic to see some of this information, and the Voyage platform's really allowed us to excel in that avenue.
Hey, Jen,
now, as far as... Go ahead.
Just 1 second. Hey, Jen, would you mind jumping back to the first Voyage slide? I just want to hit a quick note on that volume. So what... actually, the one prior, that would be great. Just a quick note here that Voyage has been really strong for us because we're able to look at mobile device-based data. So on top of our STR data and other reports we get, now we're looking at actual people coming into market based on them having certain sharing settings on their phone that allows us to see their device location. I just wanted to note to make sure there wasn't any confusion in that first bullet where it says we saw a total of 11,000 visitors. This platform that we use for the data generally sees about 3 to 7% of all visitors. So this is total devices that we were able to observe, certainly not the total number of people that in total came to the destination. So I just want to clarify that and make sure you guys knew how we were getting that data as we went through that.
Yeah, if I may, Brett, thank you for the clarification. When sure. I read that line in the local paper yesterday, I was like, that number's way off.
Yeah.
Yeah, so going forward, may need to work on that clarification before the media gets it, because they put out that we had 11,000 visitors in 5 months, which obviously we had a couple more.
Ouch. Yeah, for sure. Sorry for that, but... Yeah, it makes a lot more sense when you think about that as being maybe 3 out of 100. So, it's just one that we use, and we'll make sure we clarify that as before it goes out next time.
Yeah, and I mean, there is really value in this in terms of, you know, historically when we're trying to get this kind of data, it used to be surveys, and we would, you know, statistically it was still significant, you know, but it would be a sample size of 100, maybe 500 if you were lucky. So the fact that we can multiply that sample size, you know, by a factor of 10 is significant. That just means that, you know, the data that we're providing from, you know, a statistical standpoint is much more accurate than what we've been able to provide in the past through surveys and other means. So, but I did want to give you guys an update just in terms of our media and what we're doing. Obviously, you know, we talked about the Conversant Epsilon getting launched. Also, our connected TV with Foursquare attribution also was launched the last couple of months. And then just to give you an update on some of the big numbers that we've seen and observed, your SEM campaign has shown a marked increase in CTR since we started this campaign. It's up 47% since October. So when we started the fiscal year, we were at 8.9%. That is double the industry average. By this last month of March, we were at 13.1%, which is, you know, over almost triple. So really fantastic numbers there. The Conversant Epsilon campaign, like I mentioned, just launched, already tracking 750 messaged visits, which is also fantastic. And of course, you know, that data is going to give us also information about where they're coming from, how much they're spending when they're in destination, some of that great information, just an overall net economic impact. And then some of the other big numbers, 23 million impressions, 1.6 million video views, 314,000 clicks. All of this leads to some great web traffic, which is up over 52% year over year since the beginning of this calendar year. So.
Going into our media updates, we just finished our sponsorship with Their Life, My Lens, and also shooting our TV advertising segment with WFLA. Air date on that was just this past week on April 6th. That's also when the sweepstakes began. And then we're looking at rolling out our new creative to print publications. So it's an update, a fresher look on the creative. I've included a couple of the digital samples here. We will be rolling out all the creative to our midweek digital campaign that we're running on Conversant, and then the general campaign digital updates across the Google and Facebook platforms as well as we finish up all that creative.
So the next part of the presentation is going to talk about some of the new opportunities that we want to talk to you about. When we're already thinking about plans for the rest of the year, you know, it's kind of already crazy to think we're planning it already in 2023. So one of the opportunities that we're going to talk about focuses specifically kind of in the short term for scallop season. And then we're going to talk about three new opportunities that we really believe is going to make a significant impact, not just from a leisure marketing standpoint, but also something that will give Terry and her team the ability to really make an impact from a sales mission. Or just Terry.
Solo.
But we really think that, especially the last three tactics that we're going to talk about, you know, is really going to give us an opportunity to create yet again another award-winning campaign for you. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to John to talk a little bit about our scalloping opportunity.
Yeah, so so obviously you guys are well aware of some of the work that we did with WFLA and them doing on-location shoots and that kind of stuff. We were approached by the Tampa 10 team and their desire for to do something similar. You know, we weren't quite sure how that was going to fit into the overall marketing plan, but really when they started to present to us their OTT offerings, and it's called Premion. And really what their Premion offerings are is they're dedicated placements on their OTT platforms, which are, you know, your kind of top tier placements. So in the past, we've done OTT with Hulu, and that was fantastic. And of course, you know, I'm sure you're all familiar with Hulu and the programming they have there and all that kind of stuff. This is kind of the rest of TV that you're used to watching that isn't on Hulu. So if you think about kind of your AMC programming, your NBC programming, also these buys would actually be happening directly through those platforms. So a lot of times Hulu's doing advertising on top of some NBC programming they might have purchased in the past. This is kind of the on-demand programming that's happening in real time for those popular programs and things like that. So we were really excited about that, but of course, they wanted to charge us lots of money. We were able to actually negotiate a great rate. And the best part about that is that they've actually partnered with a company that you might be familiar with, Arrivalist, who's able to provide attribution data for this OTT buy. And that was really where it piqued my interest in terms of this having a really great value for you guys in terms of not only it being you know, a unique place to put your video ads in front of kind of a new audience and in front of audiences that may not have been able to be exposed to your messages before, but also then to be able to track that attribution and be able to track those arrivals through the Arrivalist platform back to the destination to kind of give us all that extra level of data like we have done with the Conversant Epsilon and with the Choosal buy and having that attribution with Foursquare. So so we're really excited about this. The whole program actually does allow us to get a couple of on-location shoots, and that's what we thought this would be perfect for a scalloping push, because we haven't really had you know, anyone come out and do kind of that great video footage of you know, your beautiful people scalloping and snorkeling to grab those scallops during the season. So we thought this would be a great opportunity to bring out that Tampa 10 team to do some on-location shoots, and then couple that with some OTT that, you know, slightly different than what we've done in the past, but still giving us that attribution data that that we so desire. And the plan would be for it to go for 3 months from June to August. We'd do two shoots on location that would come with some social posts and things like that. Not dissimilar to the WFLA programming that you've seen before. So we'd get some great assets out of that, some really great stuff that we can share on social ourselves, as well as some pre-roll impressions on their website. But as I mentioned before, the real value and the real difference here is being able to get on those premium placements that we haven't been able to get onto before, just because we've been a little bit priced out of that, and being able to negotiate this deal with the Tampa 10 team because they so desperately wanted to work with us and with you guys, and then being able to get that Arrivalist attribution data after the fact, so that we can kind of, you know, add that as a quiver to our cool data arsenal and really show how effective our marketing is.
And just to jump in here, one of the things too that we wanted to you know, kind of talk about here is typically the price point for the Premion platform is $100,000. So we were able to negotiate, you know, half of that rate in order to get this access to the data and the platform. So we're really excited about that, and that's actually something that we're not offering to other destinations at this time. So it would be something that would be specific to Discover Crystal River. Also, yeah. Again, because of what Brett mentioned as the larger industry trends about gas prices, and how that is affecting our summer plans of traveling, we really want to focus on scallop season in that local drive market, again, to build that awareness in the Tampa and Orlando markets that are some of our best performing markets that are nearby that people still will be able to drive and have an affordable vacation this summer as gas prices continue to rise.
And then just in case some of you aren't familiar with what Arrivalist does provide us, it is mobile-based data. And it, James, we're going to go to the next slide. We've got a few just kind of details on how what that data provides. So it is a number of exposed travelers based on the media. But the other piece that I really like with the arrival data is that will actually give us a lift information, lift comparison. So it will tell us the lift that we got with arrivals that it sees compared to non-exposed travelers to the destination based on their data set. Obviously, there's a few other things, distance traveled, where they're coming from. That kind of stuff is pretty par for the course for the mobile data, but we really do love that kind of arrival lift compared to non-exposed travelers as just a way to measure how effective the marketing campaign was.
So for this specific media opportunity, we are asking for consideration of special project funds of $50,000. The campaign would be June, July, and August. The plan then, of course, with scallop season mainly starting in July and August, we would launch with our existing scallop videos during June and then have the TV station come out in July and August and actually film then one segment each month during the peak scallop season. So that is for your consideration. So some of the other opportunities that I mentioned are these longer term ideas. We really want to see Crystal River build off of the Manatee Capital of the World brand. You know, there's such a leading movement right now in the industry as well as in the millennial and Gen Z generations of talking about sustainability and ecotourism. And we really think that Crystal River has a great opportunity to advance as being the leading voice and the leading resource for eco-friendly and sustainable tourism. So we want to see Crystal River expand on the Manatee Capital of the World platform. We want to really make sure that we're educating travelers by expanding additional educational content and becoming the place, the resource for manatee information. And we're going to do this by leveraging specific marketing and activation opportunities in various markets. So when we're thinking about what these opportunities are, how do we want to approach this, we really thought about what our mission for the campaign was going to be. And that's to position Discover Crystal River as the educational leader in eco-friendly and sustainable tourism. We want to provide additional resources so visitors can enjoy their vacations safely while understanding and respecting the environment and manatee habitations. We want to educate visitors and locals about issues facing manatee survival, such as boating issues, lack of eelgrass, over-tourism, environmental damage, and things of that nature, and encourage everyone to be better stewards of the environment and enjoy all that Discover Crystal River and the manatees have to offer. And that's not only just to visitors, but also locals alike. So when we're thinking about that and how do we activate that, one of our first tactics is talking about augmented reality. This is really cool, right? We all have a smartphone. Everybody is connected 24/7. And if we don't have our phones with us, you know, sometimes we feel naked, like we're forgetting a piece of ourselves, right? So everybody has access to this device. Now, when augmented reality first came about, you know, you had to have Oculus glasses or you had to have some other piece of technology. You had to download an app. We are proposing that we do native web-based augmented reality where you don't have to download an app. You don't have to have special equipment or goggles. You literally just have to have your smartphone. So imagine Stepping Into Awesome is our campaign name, right? So imagine stepping into a portal, an augmented reality portal, that then you can experience Discover Crystal River and the manatees for yourself, just with your phone. We want to be able to show in the portal perhaps water that is murky, water that is polluted, water that has not had those conservation efforts. There's a lack of sealgrass or dying eelgrass. Maybe there's a piece of trash, not really any manatee swimming. But then as you scroll over, you see healthy, crystal clear water. You see healthy eelgrass. You see happy manatees swimming about and really see those conservation efforts in real life. And then part of the other portal would give you access to educational resources, how you could get involved, how you could donate, how you could volunteer, things to get you involved in sustainable and eco-friendly tourism as well. We also are proposing this because not only are there great media activations for this and a really significant opportunity for the leisure tourism market, as I mentioned before, this would be something so great for Terry to use in her media missions, her sales missions, trade shows, during seminars that we would have, or educational opportunities working with the zoos, things like that. But for Terry specifically, you know, think about how cool it would be for when she's in Germany talking to tour operators and she pulls up her phone or tells the tour operators, pull up your phone, scan this QR code. Let's see Discover Crystal River. Let's discover Crystal River for ourselves. They can pull up their phone and pull up this augmented reality experience and get to see it for themselves. How much more immersive and real life could it get for someone in Germany who may not really be able to picture what Crystal River is like, to then get to see and experience it for themselves, to want to say, yes, I want to bring a group here. I want to come here. I want to see this for myself. I want to go swim with the manatees. So there's a lot of different opportunities from that educational standpoint, but also from a sell standpoint. This would also be a great opportunity for fam tours and riders, right? So getting those people involved and being excited about the destination itself. And lastly, with augmented reality, because all of this will be custom developed, we would actually own the files. So we could use this not just for this specific AR environment, but we could use it for other things such as 3D IMAX placements in future campaigns or in our next fiscal budget. The cost of this is $186,000 that we're asking for consideration. That does include the full AR experience, the design development work, as well as a 12-month subscription for the hosting, since it is web-based. Now, if you're like myself, I'm a visual person. I want to see a little bit of this in real life. So on the next slide, we've got some visual examples. So as you see, the campaign name is Step Into Awesome. So can you go back one? Thank you. So the campaign name is Step Into Awesome. So here we have an image of what it would look like on your phone as you scroll through the portal. You would see, imagine scanning that code, a QR code, and then it opening up to Three Sisters Springs. Each portal would contain a completely custom 360 3D environment, which users can use in any direction, scan their phones, and see the environment for themselves. As I mentioned, part of it, you know, maybe on the left-hand side is that murky water, but on the right is the crystal clear water. So it really gives you that opportunity to see all of this for yourself and to learn more about the habitats and really what that impact is. On the next slide, this is how we also kind of envision, once you get into the portal, what that 3D environment would look like. Because we would be filming in 360, we really can make sure that the creative elements are kind of exactly what we are looking for. This involves not only filming 3D and underwater, but it also uses CGI animation and effects as well. So you can see here, we've got some panels divided as it would be appearing on your phone. And you could see there, you could tap now on the manatee to maybe talk about manatee educational experiences. You can scroll over to see some of that portal on the murky water, and then on the right-hand side, what it would look like for that crystal clear water. So again, just a super immersive experience that we really think has a lot of legs and a lot of activation opportunities. The next slide, we also envision, this is an example too of what we were talking about with the 3D animation for the IMAX. So how cool would it be in our next fiscal plan, as theaters are coming back, as more people are going, we can put these in select key markets based upon the research that we've gathered from our Conversant data and our Premion data, and really see this experience come to life for themselves. So this isn't included in the current media plan. We are planning to include that in next year's fiscal budget. Not as a special project request.
The IMAX part?
The IMAX part, yeah. So again, just talking about that AR capability and what all we can do with that, we also really wanted to think, how can we expand this opportunity? And we really wanted to focus on in-market activations at zoos. So I'm gonna let Jennifer talk to us a little bit about our zoo activation opportunity.
Thanks, TJ. So we've been in discussion with several zoos around the country, a couple of local ones, Zoo Tampa and Clearwater Marine Aquarium, as well as a couple that are out of market. We're really focusing on those zoos that have manatees already in captivity, or they're working with manatee conservation programs and those kinds of things. Cincinnati Zoo in particular is super excited about partnering with Crystal River on this kind of in-market activation. We propose taking an in-person team out there for a Friday, Saturday, Sunday type of an activation, having a manatee mascot that would be owned by Crystal River and a spokesperson from Crystal River out there at the manatee exhibit itself, talking about Crystal River, really engaging those people that are at the zoos who are already interested in looking at the manatees to encourage them to come out and visit them in person. We propose using digital media to support these activations to let people know about them in coordination with the zoo themselves, who would help with promoting our in-market visit. And we also propose using the new AR portal and launching that portal at these particular events. We would have signage, we would have, of course, the in-market person. And so visitors that are actually visiting the live manatees there can do the portal on their phone and see how it would be if they were swimming with the manatees themselves, because the portal itself, as TJ mentioned, will be animated. So those manatees will be swimming around with you in the portal. Addition to that, we're looking at geofencing and retargeting those zoo visitors where the manatees are kept. So we propose a near Uber Media 3-month flight that would retarget those visitors that we capture in that market, and then execute some complimentary PR efforts with Hayworth. And finally, engage those people that are there with an enter to win trip to come and actually swim with the manatees. So we would get signups, you would get those leads from each one of the activations. So what we're looking for is to do about a $50,000 per location activation for each one of the zoos.
And just to expand upon that, specifically about the enter to win and the sweepstakes opportunity, we wanted to have that not just from a lead generation standpoint to build the database. When we collect that information, you know, we can send out visitor guides, we can add them to the newsletter database, and then we can also incorporate their email addresses to expand upon our lookalike audiences as well. So again, it's kind of, we're looking for the most efficiencies as well, where we can get the maximum kind of bang for your buck out of the campaign. Talking about those markets that we have looked at, we looked at Zoo Tampa, the Clearwater Marine Aquarium, the Columbus Zoo, and the Cincinnati Zoo. Specifically with the Cincinnati Zoo, for example, they actually have the largest social media following of any zoo in the world. If you're familiar with Fiona the hippo from a year or two, a couple of years ago, that's where Fiona lives. So she has the largest social media presence of any animal at any zoo. So even if she says, if Miss Fiona says, hey, come out and swim with Mandy and Manny the manatee, people really get excited about that, and there's opportunities for us to, you know, even potentially go viral. One other aspect with these zoo activations is the zoos themselves have built-in networks for educational resources and support. So we can really leverage the zoos for sustainability and ecotourism groups, as well as education, working with the schools. They already have that network of field trips built in. But also, again, going back to Cincinnati, they even have a charter school that is geared towards animals and rehabilitation. So there's lots of legs that we can pull from to really expand upon this, not just from a media activation, but also then, you know, from the educational standpoint as well. And while we are proposing doing a 3-day in-market activation, this campaign would actually have a presence, you know, for at least 3 months, not just the 3 days. So with that, we need to figure out a way to pull it all in, right? We're talking about a lot of information, a lot of content, a lot of resources. So how do we get that? On the next slide, we are talking about how we expand upon that opportunity and expand the manatee capital of the world. So we want to design a unique educational portal within your existing website. So it would still live on your website. You get all the benefit of the content, the SEO, the analytics, all the traffic, and it would just be a landing page on the website that is geared specifically towards this educational campaign. We are proposing consistent flow of information and educational content and distribution. We're proposing to do at least 2 content blogs a month for 6 months, as well as doing 2 custom first-person stories and presentation layers to really get kind of a next-level immersive experience, not just from a standard blog post, but a really engaging website that will draw people in and really push them to other stories, other resources on the website itself. Again, this content too is going to be geared for different age groups. So while part of the campaign is specifically geared towards educational groups, school children, maybe boomers, right, aren't going to be talked to in the same way. They're not going to have necessarily the same interest as, 8 and 10 year olds. So with the boomers, we might be gearing that information towards how you can get involved, how you can donate, how you can make a difference to your environment. We will also, again, going back to the zoos, partner with education and remote learning-based organizations to help expand this opportunity. There are several higher-level education programs, marine biologists, things like that, that are constantly looking for opportunities to expand their research and their awareness of their programs. And lastly, we're proposing that we use existing digital media funds, so not adding to that that media budget, but using some of the funds within our existing media plan to really push that messaging and push that content out. So for this third leg of the campaign, we are asking for consideration of $28,500 in special funds. I realize I didn't say that on the zoo activation, but for the zoo activation, the request for funding is $50,000 per location, and we're suggesting 4 locations. But of course, you can pick 2 or 1, but we are recommending doing 4. So with that, I am happy to answer any questions that you might have, and we'll leave it to you for discussion. We are super excited about this campaign. We really, again, cannot stress enough how many legs that we see, and really believe that this could be another award-winning campaign for Discover Crystal River and really set you apart from other destinations. Thank you.
Awesome. The thing that I am most excited about is taking the lead on ecotourism and being responsible about our environment, because that is absolutely what came about from our strategic planning sessions last week for the county, and certainly that fits with the Nature Coast. But other than that, I'll let the board comment. I have other comments, but I want to hear from y'all.
I'm wondering, is there a way to plug some of this into the Visit Florida Visitor Centers?
Absolutely.
Was that considered, or was it already ruled out?
So that's a part of kind of those market activations that we would look at. Typically, beyond just the rack cards and things like that, Visit Florida potentially would allow us to put a QR code, such as like a door cling or something, where they could scan the QR code while they're there at the Welcome Center and open up that portal there. So that is something that, if we get approval to move forward with, that would be something we would absolutely consider.
I think a bunch of video monitors, have, TV screens too. So I have no idea what the pricing is on that. It might be, completely insane.
But this is only used on your phone.
This would only be mobile? Okay.
I mean, in theory, you could put, if we ran ads on the TV with the QR code there, like, for example, Coinbase, the commercial on the Super Bowl, right, had just the QR code bouncing on the screen the whole time. And you're like, what is that? So you go and scan your phone, then that would open up the portal. But the portal itself, is only on your phone. But there are opportunities, absolutely, to work with Visit Florida.
The AR thing is pretty cool, I have to say. And especially being able to go to IMAX downstream. As far as the 10 Tampa thing goes, I think that sounds like a really good program to do. I would ask the tour operators here if we are maxed out on capacity for scalloping, or, okay. From an ad, you know, I'm new to the board. From an ad agency standpoint, totally makes sense because I think you know that's my background. But I'm not a tour operator, so as long as we're not advertising to empty shelves, I'm good with it. So.
Hey, DJ, I'll just I want to add when we did talk with the Cincinnati Zoo, one of the highest their peak time is actually in the month of December with the zoo lights timing. And that was actually their suggestion for when we should come out. So timing-wise, that actually works with an idea to plan for visitation, you know, and their summer trips and be able to come out in December or January or February, those kinds of things. The portal does take several months to develop, so I wouldn't see that the portal would be available, you know, necessarily in June, but later this year, late summer, depending on how quickly it got developed.
Yeah, it'd be really cool to have like a grand opening of the portal at Manatee, the opening of Manatee season.
Absolutely, and so that's why we're asking for this consideration now, because when we started talking with the various AR development companies, it takes between 5 and 7 months to get this concept actually developed, so that's why we need a little bit of lead time in order to really flush this out and get it ready for manatee season. So while we are proposing, you know, one tactic specifically for scallop season for that short-term activation, this is looking for moving into your 2023 fiscal year. So this the zoo activations, the AR, that would all be for the start of manatee season.
Madam Chair, are you looking to vote on this today?
I believe so.
Can we talk about how much money we have in the bank?
And I That's apologize why I pulled it up.
for not being here for a while. But,
yeah.
How much money do we have, because they just backed the truck up.
So $739
is what's in
special projects.
Well, we're trying to figure out one other thing, too. I think state law says you can only take the base contract and increase the base contract 25%. But John just went over and was checking with purchasing.
Yeah, I'm looking with purchasing because it's we have two contracts with Madden. We have the like the retainer every month.
Okay.
And then we have the media. So I did go speak with Linda Morrison, the purchasing, and I'll check back afterwards to see what the mechanics would be if we decided to move forward with, you know, the sizable purchase. I mean, the if you did the TV one, that's fairly routine. That's not really the issue. It's the other ones if we decide to move forward.
The 186 would be the big one.
Well, yeah, everything other than the TV would be. We're double checking what the mechanics would be. I don't know if it's, and we'll find out and we can report back. And I don't know, I know it's a lot today. There's a lot of information I don't know that we have to decide today. When I spoke to Madden, it's a, you know, it may be something that we bring back next month for the vote, so everybody has time to digest it and look about it a little bit. But as a staff, we think the three options of some level, whether it's one zoo, two zoo, we think those three things are something that is very different for us and puts us out in the forefront. And the fact that we could be at the Columbus or Cincinnati Zoo and have that presence with their exhibits is something that's we haven't done before. And the fact that the portal lives for 12 months gives us other, as Mike was talking about, that maybe the Visit Florida Welcome Centers, we, you know, signage at Three Sisters, all those type of things. It's not just a short term campaign, kind of like the television one. So from our side, we're very excited about that they brought forward those other three, and I think it touches more what we've been asking for in terms of out of the box and true new projects that fit into the mold of what the special projects account is for. So
One other thing that I would say specifically about Columbus and Cincinnati is, you know, we also see this as an opportunity to steal market share and gain some traction in a market that we don't own yet. So we do see some opportunity here, not just because they have manatees and have rehabilitation and sustainability resources, but because we do feel like there is an opportunity to build that awareness and engagement in those markets to steal market share.
Madam Chair.
Yes, sir.
I want to make this as short as I can, but I have a lot of thoughts about this. I swear I'll make it as short as I can. Number one, I'm excited about our destination, and I think whether there's a recession or whether, you know, people's cash are going to take them through, I don't care what the economic situation is. I think COVID proved that we have a destination that people are going to want to come to, and once they discover, we're not going to suffer. I mean, I think our destination is exciting, and we're going to prosper no matter what. So that's, to me, two different things, the scallop opportunity. My fear is that we're marketing, because we're worried about gas prices and because we're saying close-in drive market, a lot of folks in Tampa know we're the place to come scalloping. So are we truly marketing to people who already know about the opportunity in a market that's already full? I don't know that. That's kind of more of a question for me.
That's kind of where I was going with that.
Right. I mean, it sounds like a good idea, but I'm not sure it is. And really, I would rely on you guys to say, should we focus on midweek scalloping opportunities? Are we full on the weekends? Are we not doing any good? Is Tampa already saturated with folks who know and are coming up here? So I don't know about that. I have less problems with that. I mean, scalloping is a thing that we need to promote, and it brings people here, and it's the next thing up. And I'm always, I should have said at the beginning, because our destination is so exciting, I'm a pedal to the floor on spending money, because that's what we're supposed to do, right? That's what the money's for. So I'm pedal to the metal on spending money, but not foolishly. So is that $50,000 wise? If it is, I'm all about spending it.
I definitely appreciate that concern. Jen, if you could go back to that slide specifically, the OTT slide.
Yeah.
We purposely did not list the markets. We put drive markets on our slide. Mm-hmm. And part of that is where we were going to work with the DCR team to decide which markets were going to be. Our initial thoughts were the kind of Tampa and Orlando market. However, and that's, again, based on the research showing, you know, that is where the majority of those people come from. However, there are other opportunities that we can look at. So based upon the last Conversant campaign that we ran, you know, Jacksonville, for example, was identified.
St. Augustine, Jacksonville, West Palm Beach. Yeah. I mean, during COVID, we found that people... Now it's a drive market. They'll come here.
Absolutely. And so one of the reasons, again, why I didn't list the market specifically here was because, like with Jacksonville, for example, they were identified as a market, but they didn't spend as much money as people did, say, from Orlando. So we were going to work and kind of nail down those target markets based upon what resources DCR wanted to put into the markets. So we are, you know, flexible there on which markets that we can target.
Well, I guess on that opportunity, I'm flexible depending on what the smarter board members think about that. I mean, that sounds okay to me and maybe a good idea. The second whole thing, all I keep thinking in my mind is this is enhanced video. I mean, you can call it virtual reality. It's enhanced video. I mean, it's on your phone. It's a video on your phone. And I can move my phone around, and there's different stuff. It's really cool, whiz bang, but it's enhanced video. That's what it is, and it's $186,000. How can you use that enhanced video? Yeah, we can do in-market or in-zoo activations. That's a good idea. I question, so I'll say my conflict. I represent SeaWorld. So I see going to a zoo, I think, well, you know, we're kind of at the hub of all rehab and rehabilitation of manatees, and so, you know, might be a good place to do it there. But is a zoo really going to let you come in and say, hey, take people out of your zoo and send them to Crystal River?
I mean, yes, we've had those conversations. We've had those conversations.
They're excited about that.
They are.
It would be cool. I mean, people would love it, and then they're going to say, hey, let's go to Crystal River and not go to the Zoo Tampa.
Yep. We haven't gone, you know, fully in depth with them. Of course, we talked to them at a very high level about the opportunity and what we are planning. But they said absolutely this was something that was in line with their mission as well. And even depending on, you know, how far we can push the education, the sustainability message with our educational resources, they would even then consider, you know, potentially lowering what it would cost to actually, you know, sponsor or have that space.
Right.
Because it aligns with their mission so well. They would be doing it as a part of their fees or their mission too.
Right.
So the zoos are all for this.
So I would tell you SeaWorld would probably partner with you too because it's a great idea. But what we're really talking about is do we spend $186,000 for enhanced video? And then separately, where can we use that enhanced video? In an IMAX theater, in an in-market activation for a zoo or something like that. So to me, that's what I'm thinking. Is the enhancement to the video worth $186,000 per year? And what's the recurring cost on that? Because I know there's development of the video portal for 12 months. And then what's the recurring cost next year for the portal?
Yep, so thank you. The 186 is just a one-time development cost.
Okay.
The hosting of that after the first year is around $36,000. Now that can fluctuate depending on how many views we get because this is a hosting platform. The current budget allows for 500,000 views per month.
Okay.
So that we can scale and decide on how far we want to go. There is an option, a tier above and a tier below. But yeah, it's only 36,000 for years two and onwards.
Mm-hmm. Would
and then,
go ahead.
I would say, TJ, it's a little bit more advanced than an enhanced video. So as you move around, as you turn around, you're getting a three-dimensional, not just look. So it's not a flat screen look. You can actually walk into the portal. You can have, as you're looking through the phone, the manatees will be coming three-dimensionally off to the side of you, in front of you. You can turn around and follow the manatees. It's a very interactive, three-dimensional space.
Yep, immersive.
Do you have any samples of that?
Exactly
we do. We've got some here at the end of our deck. It might be a little choppy. It might be something that rather than the screen share.
Go on realtor.com. People are selling houses with it. I mean, that's
absolutely
about is
even
that's how people buy houses without ever visiting them. They use this technology. So I get it.
Yep.
It's enhanced video. I mean, it's enhanced video. And to your point, I understand it's really enhanced video. But that's the question. Do we spend $186,000 to get these super duper? It's like, do we want a better booth for our trade show, right? Do we want to spruce up and have a booth? And then where are we going to take our booth for our trade show? Is it worth the expenditure to have super duper video? I mean, I might be able to get there. I'm not saying I'm against it, but just in my very simple mind, do we want to spend that money for enhanced video and then have the conversation about where are we going to show our new whiz bang video, right? I mean, that's kind of where I'm at.
So at the end of the day too, without it, we couldn't do the things like the 3D IMAX, right? Because we are filming this specifically for the AR technology or the AR portal, we then own those files and can do other things with it. So the 3D IMAX would be something that wouldn't cost us extra from a production standpoint necessarily. That would be, you know, a media placement then because we've already got those files created.
Mm-hmm.
So there are multiple uses that we could do. And again, going back to like even with the in-market zoo activations and with Terry and using it for sales missions, this is something to really engage people and to get them interacting with the brand because a whole thing too, especially when we're looking about the future of technology and the internet, we're now moving into Web 3 and the content or creation. And so with Web 3, it is becoming more one-on-one and personalized experiences. And really with augmented reality, that is what we're gearing towards, is how we can get one person, one individual to interact with that brand, not just having, you know, mass brand awareness, but how can we engage and immerse ourselves in Crystal River.
So I hear you. But you're talking to a destination that's been fabulously successful with what we're doing. And today you're saying we have a typewriter or we need to get a PC. You're saying that what we're doing now is becoming outdated or may become outdated and we need to move to the next level, right? So I'm prepared to hear that, but maybe not in a 30-minute span and realize that what I thought was a Jaguar running on all 12 cylinders is actually a Yugo and we need to think about moving up. That's all. I mean, that's all I'm saying. I'm not saying it's not worth the money. I'm not saying you're not exactly correct as the expert in the field, that this is where we need to move to. It's just, boy, I came in this morning thinking we were doing well, and now I'm like, what do you sell with now? Like, take what you sell with now and go put you in SeaWorld by the manatee rehab rehabilitation tank and tell me you couldn't do the same thing? I mean,
well,
we don't have resources to, not as whiz-bang as this, not as cool as this, but could we do it?
Well, one of the things I would address to what you said, too, is you go to these trade shows now, especially when you're international or farther away than, you know, our drive market, and a lot of the destinations are using these immersive ocular things right. to experience it. And
they are, okay.
Well, and so you talk about doing booth, you know, enhance the booth. Well, I could show up with a six-foot table and a Crystal River tablecloth on it and two chairs, and if I had something like this, that's all I'd need. You know, of course, I wouldn't do that. But that's where everything is going. And then and on top of that, the video enhancement, that 3D, that's where the technology is going. So we'd already be ahead of that curve. We'd have to spend the money eventually anyway.
And I would like to point to, while we may still be driving a Jaguar, what he's telling us is that Teslas are available.
Love,
and one day,
I like that metaphor.
So, yes, what we have is fantastic and beautiful right. and wonderful and will sell itself to some degree always. We've always asked them for the opportunity to find something more, something new, something innovative, and I think that's what they've done for
us. Don't get me wrong. I love this discussion, right? This is exactly the kind of discussion we want to have. I just want to be skeptical before I, in 30 minutes, jump into spending $500,000.
Absolutely.
Right?
Yes. One other thing that I would mention, too, since you brought up the videos, we're going to continue to recommend investing in video resources. You know, if anything, COVID taught us that streaming video and OTT and connected TV, that is the direction of the future. You know, more and more people are watching their video. When everything shut down, right, there was a huge significant shift in viewership and watching videos. We saw the time spent watching videos just skyrocket. So videos are going to continue to be a relevant and a major tactic that we're going to use for the future of our plans, you know, regardless.
I yield the rest of my time, Madam. I
do have a couple of comments. I'm going to throw out some pretty big brand names, but we need to understand too that we really are the manatee capital of the world. Chipotle and McDonald's have now already invested in the metaverse. So I was just reading that in Wall Street Journal. So we are transitioning into pretty much a crazy new world. And to Terry's point, 3 years, 4 years ago, I was at the DEMA show, the scuba diving trade show. Mm-hmm. And I love dive liveaboards. And I stumbled into an international dive liveaboard. Sadly, can't remember the name off the top of my head. It was only one exposure, though, right? And I do have it in my office. But I still remember it. He had me put the whole AR headset on, and I walked around the dive boat. It was the coolest thing ever, you know? So there is some blending of all that, and I would love to, are we going to be able to take these files and do full immersive AR with those files? If we wanted to downstream?
I believe that we do have that availability to do like Oculus glasses. The reason that we decided to go with the web-based AR was where you didn't have to do that, right? Where
I'm
you
not
could...
talking, it's not mutually exclusive. I'm talking about both.
Right, yes. So there, I do think that there is that opportunity if we want to go down that route. Mm-hmm. Part of it, too, was, again, just from thinking about, you know, do we want to package this up and ship Oculus glasses to all the trade shows and booths and things like that from just a cost savings perspective rather than just, you know, scanning a QR code.
Right.
So I do think that it would be possible if that is something that y'all would like to move forward with. But it doesn't have to be.
I was just curious. It's not a today thing remotely, a today thing. I was just curious but I would really like to see some samples of what the AR that you're talking about is. Just before we do that kind of a swing mm-hmm. on the money, but I'm 98% sold. How's that?
I mean, let's Jen, if you want to try pulling
yep.
it up.
I have it up. I can pull it over.
It might be just a little choppy due to the streaming, but it should give you an idea. Now, this isn't a one-for-one, you know, perfect example. I believe Jen, are you showing the Halloween?
Yep. Give me just a quick second to.
This one is going to show you an example of, like, you download an app for it. Again, we're not suggesting building an app. This would be a QR code, but this would be a close representation of what it would be.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So again, in our version, it would just scan, directly open the portal, none of this downloading the app. And then this is where, as users are going to scroll, you know, in our example, you know, maybe a manatee would appear and start swimming with you.
Hey, TJ, we'll keep rolling. Let's share a couple of these links out to the group.
Yep.
It's just, it's okay seeing the video, but it's just not going to have the same impact unless we do it on our phones individually.
The company has a demo.
It's not going to do a good job of selling it, trying to do it on YouTube here.
Yeah. One of the examples they showed us on the other day, there's a demo reel from the company that shows their capabilities. I think that might give the board a better idea of what's really capable, because it is. That is more closer to an apple to apple. Here's how we develop it, and this is versus the Halloween one, I think.
I can pull that real quick. That's an easy pull right here.
It's just so choppy. I think it'd be better if we sent them the links, right?
Yeah.
We'll
just forward them out, and then you can.
The other option would be, unless y'all want to just pull up YouTube directly on your computer.
Yeah, we could do that.
Oh, well, that one's working, it seems.
That one's working much better.
I don't know how she's doing that.
What's the company?
It's called Gravity Jack, and they're one of the leading AR companies across the U.S. They work with all national brands.
Gravity Jack, as in J-A...
J-C-K, Gravity Jack.
Like it's supposed to be.
Jack and Jill. Yeah.
Rarely do they have words that they misspell gravity.
So is this targeting younger age groups?
So this could be, you know, with a variety of targets. So going, you know, to the zoo activations, that's going to be more geared towards families and school children. It could also be targeted for the tour operators at sales missions, fam tours, riders. You know, that where we activate the AR portal is totally open to our targeting.
Yeah. I have a lot of guests who are older. I have the QR code on business cards and my brochures and everything. They will not touch it. Yes, we refuse to take the picture. I can sit there, show them how to do everything. They're like, no, just let me type it in.
Yep.
Exactly.
So it's also a big problem if we want to spend the most money. Half the people we're trying to bring in refuse to do it because it's too new.
Yep. So, in addition to, you know, just the QR code, under the QR code, we would have the URL that you could type in if you wanted to do that. But we are seeing just across the board more and more adoption of QR across all of our age groups. Even most of our clients, even now with Crystal River, we put QR codes on print ads where we can track the measurement even of the print ad itself.
Thank you, COVID.
Yeah.
We saw a huge increase during COVID, you know, because everybody went contactless, right? You didn't want to touch the menus and things like that. Yeah.
They still don't like it.
Yeah. But that again, too, is where, like, with our activations, we would have, you know, maybe Mandy the manatee there, you know, manning that activation booth, helping users engage with the activation itself, getting them to understand how, you know, how that technology works and to open it with that activation.
Why is it so expensive, $186,000 to make this?
It's $150,000 for the development and $36,000 for the hosting. And that is just simply the cost of 3D production. I mean, we are talking about filming in 3D, filming underwater, and then doing CGI animation as well. So lots of development. That's also why the lead time is between 5 and 7 months, because there's a lot of work that will go into this.
It will literally be Crystal River.
Yeah.
It will be Three Sisters Springs or wherever we decide to, you know, have that environment be. So it won't be just manatees in general. It's going to be your location specifically.
I personally don't have any concerns about their price tag. It's just, it sounds like we probably need to wait a month before we take a vote on it, and we can really look into it.
So does it include, besides manatees, scalloping, fishing, boating, kayaking, canoeing, trail riding, all that stuff, or is this simply in a augmented on the manatee water side?
So, go ahead. I'm sorry. This is your deal, not mine.
You can answer. I'm fine with that.
Damn it, Terry.
So the main focus would be manatees, right? I mean, this is an expansion of the Manatee Capital of the World campaign. However, as we talked kind of, you know, that left side and the right side of the two versions, they're kind of in the middle. We're planning on having other information. So how you can get involved, how you can be, you know, eco-friendly, and then talk about other opportunities within Crystal River. So it would not necessarily be, you know, the fully blown out, you know, about all of those specific topics, but we would absolutely, you know, drive links for, you know, to your landing pages on the Discover Crystal River website where you could access that information.
Is it Oscar worthy? I
mean, well, it is award worthy. I don't know about Oscars, but
Flagler award,
at least. Yeah, at least a Flagler.
More than that.
Story idea, digging the life of a golf ball.
who's playing the ball?
Right, and then you can explore the murky water and the clear water and the beach. Yeah. And
as long as you promise me
they're
no alligators.
Month, right?
They can't back promise that.
We can.
I thought
I think June is the media plan presentation.
It's
a little bit late. We haven't really started the. I just submitted the budget, so we haven't really started cutting it up yet.
So
on that side,
if we're talking about pushing it until next month, I would ask for consideration for the OTT scallop tactic to be voted on today, just because, you know, we're trying to get that launched quicker. What was that?
That's the Tampa Bay 10.
Yes. But pushing the other three tactics to next month, that would be fine, but we would probably need a decision by next month in order to have enough time for the lead development of the AR.
I'm okay with it, actually. The first 10 days, we don't need any help. Weekends in July, we don't need any help. Could use some help midweek in July. It's August. First 2 weeks are okay. Weekends are full. And then after the second week in August, then we need help from the last 2 weeks of August all the way through the 24th of September. So, yeah, I mean, it's got decent enough growth. And it's a popular thing. You can make good better easier than you can make bad good. So it would be, if we could augment, like I say, the middle of the week for the whole season and then the last 6 weeks of the programs, 5 weeks of the program, if we focus it that way, yeah, I mean, and I guess streaming is the way to go. Although I don't know why I'm paying for all these services we never watch, but I don't know if anybody else in the world is like that either. So you did it, you got it all up, and you did it for 42 days, and now you're back on cable. But the rest of the world may not be me, so. I think it's a great idea. I mean, we had a great support with the Hulu thing we did. Mm-hmm. It's the way people are looking at stuff, I guess.
Yep. We're pretty much the same way on my end, too. I mean, like the first 6 weeks or so, midweek or whatever, we don't need any help. Need more spaces if you need anything, you know. It gets toward the end, just winding down. Probably the last 4 weeks of the season. Like I said, the last two in August and the first two in September or whatever is when it really winds down. School's starting back up, or people are spending their money on new school supplies, and you know, just changes things. The first 6 weeks, though, school's out, it's July. Nobody cares what anything costs. Let's just go have fun.
The hotels will.
And good luck finding a spot to stay.
We need the midweek stuff at the hotel side.
Yeah.
Well, then we would need, you know, to reach out to the lodging partners or the tour operator partners and ask for, you know, midweek packages, perhaps midweek specials or that you can let us know about
value,
that we can promote on there.
Value proposition.
Right.
Is what it's about. Challenges, there's nothing to compare it to. Because if you say it's 30% cheaper than coming on the weekend, they're like, well, I can't get anything on the weekends. How do I know it's 30% cheaper?
I would also remind you that we have a Bandwango campaign and platform that you have the ability to put specials on.
Right.
And I believe that we are either in the process or had just reached out or about to reach out to all of the partners that are participating to see if you would like to refresh those coupons and deals. But that is something absolutely that we could then put, you know, that midweek message as a coupon even, because we do have a campaign for Bandwango that runs throughout the rest of this fiscal year.
Michael, listening to you, do those dates work? Does it make, you were saying would it be better to push it 1 month later so that we're still talking to them in September when the season's still going, or those dates?
Well, no, because, I mean, most people will make their decision 30 days ahead of time.
Okay.
So at least that. So that you got to promote in June to get July. You got to promote in July to get August. You got to promote in August to get September.
Okay.
Not that a refresher within, and again, this day and age, we have, there's three different types of people still. Those that year out make their reservations, they know they're going, they want it. And there's that thoughtfulness of 30 to 60, 90 days out. And then there's the rush, depending on conditions, very conditional.
Yeah.
Today for tomorrow.
I would say
they wait for the weather forecast.
We have all three.
Weather's a big deal.
Yep. I would also say that we would still have just in our existing like regular budget of the fiscal year plan, we still do have a scalloping season budget
right.
that would continue to live past August.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that would kind of work. I guess I'm like with Gina on the thing, defining the drive market would be interesting. Because again, we've opened up in my mind. We're like Jacksonville to Palm Beach, and sort of come across and
right.
then up, and then back into just south of Sarasota, and I don't know, Gainesville. But then Cedar Key doesn't care.
right. No,
well,
you're
then
it come funnels
I would
right back
too,
in.
That we are not nowhere near touching the Tampa Bay market.
Oh, and I would.
And I realize that most of our scalpers come from there, but. I still go to events in Tampa where people are like, "Oh, where's Crystal River? What
right.
do I do there?"
Okay.
I will
and
tell
this
you.
Is a totally different market too. This is the CBS, right?
CBS.
Yeah.
CBS. NBC's okay. WFLA.
CBS is sort of a different market than the viewers for the FLA market, the NBC market. So.
Yeah, to speak to your
I like this one.
To your concern about were we oversaturating Tampa? No.
No. Okay.
Even never. Within Crystal River, I would be like, "Oh, you're going to come to our Sunday? How do I know about it? Well, did you read the Chronicle? Go online, do it." And people in town still don't know we have a Sunday brunch.
Gotcha.
So.
Gotcha. Well, I mean, I'm comfortable with that one. I mean, I'll if we can separate the two, I'll make a motion that we go with the $50,000 project.
Yeah, they're individual options. It's not not a package.
Yeah, well, I'll make a motion that we adopt the recommendation of Madden for the $50,000 scalp.
Gene made a
project.
Motion. I heard a second over there. Mike Shoemaker. Any public discussion or board discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries unanimously.
Just me personally, I'd like to wait a month because... I came here to this meeting with a Jaguar. I got to go talk to my wife about buying a Tesla. I don't.
So
it's the future.
I don't know.
Is it okay to wait for the zoo and the AR till next month? Then?
It is.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yep.
It's going to take 5 to 7 months anyway, right?
So we should buy shares and strip mining.
Yeah.
Because the Tesla's coming.
Lithium.
And John, with the other program, the 186K, the 50K per site, et cetera, can some of that be put into the budget that would go into effect October 1 and not necessarily kind of all special projects? Would that alleviate some of the contract type stuff?
It's a thought.
I'm not certain that
just spitballing.
Yeah. So I'm working with purchasing. I understand what Randy says, and I'm not fully versed on what's what on that, because this is a media purchase as opposed to changing what we pay them every month in the retainer. So Linda Morris, like I said, is looking into it, and we'll be able to send out an answer as soon as we have one as to what the if we decide to move forward with the bigger numbers, here's the process. Here's what we have to do if we choose to do it. And it may be as simple as I stand before the BOCC and present it. That would be, you know, and that's an easier one than some paperwork. But
and I will say we actually did consider that in that last slide about the Manatee expansion with the educational content.
Mm-hmm.
That last bullet point was using existing media within the fiscal year plan budget, because before we were going to allocate another $50,000 to drive additional exposure, where then as we were thinking about it, we do already have plans within our media campaigns that do similar tactics. So we decided that it would be money better spent to focus on the zoo activations and the AR development, and then use some of those existing funds to push out that educational content. We still have to create the content itself and, you know, the stories, but then we can use that existing media budget to push that out.
Well, it's a good point. In my mind, creation of the immersive environment is one issue, and then what you do with it is a second issue, right? So, yep. I mean, I would want to be prepared next month when we come back to vote on whether we want to take the step to create it or not. And then I would think the Cincinnati Zoo is going to want to see what you have before they commit a price or whatever. Or do you feel like next month we would need to authorize you to do four locations at 50? In other words, do you need that 200 grand commitment before we commit to making the video, since that's 5 to 7 months? You see what I mean? I'm trying to spend a little bit of money instead of spending like the whole thing at one time.
Yeah, I mean, it would be helpful to have everything voted on at the same time because of the production. Then that way, I mean, because if, say, for example, you approve the zoos but you don't approve the AR, that changes, you know, like what...
We're not going to do the zoos without the
Well,
AR.
Exactly, right? So it does change the way that we would do the activations or do the media plan moving forward. So it would be helpful to have it all voted on at once.
All right. Well, I'd like to wait. I don't know if that needs a motion or what, but...
I think we have board consensus to wait on a vote. Nobody's making a motion, so that's enough of a structure on it. Okay.
Thank you all very much for your consideration. Appreciate
it. Thank you.
No, thanks for presenting it. We do appreciate that.
Thanks for bringing the big ideas.
Yeah. Absolutely.
All right. Director of Media Report.
Arizona people, you can go back to bed.
Yeah. Back to sleep, John.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thanks. All right. So, stepping down in technology.
Well, you know why.
All right. So yeah, as we go back, downscale the, like I said, downscale the technology options here. So the first item on the report is the Brand USA Travel Week in Frankfurt. This is something that is. It taps into the market that we weren't able to participate in this year, with ITB being canceled because of an outbreak, and plus Visit Florida is stepping away from that. So now we have the potential to still attend and be part of Brand USA at the Berlin show, but what I've seen from those things it doesn't have the same pop as being at the Visit Florida stand. So without Visit Florida being there, I'm not sure Berlin is an option, is good an option. This, as I mentioned in the memo, Brand USA did one in the UK leading up to World Travel Mark, and I heard excellent from my colleagues' interactions. It's much more targeted. Smaller supplier numbers, smaller and more targeted vendors coming to speak. So I think the idea makes sense for us to participate in this and then we'll know it's whether we continue with it. I believe I put it in the budget for next year, thinking that it was gonna work, whether we do it now or then. But I do think this is a chance to be in market once more, and with the help of our without leave, and we can really make this a successful event. So it's sending two participants to it, and so it's we have the travel money already. It's $9,500 for it's to attend, and I'm 95% sure that it's still in the travel budget. I mean, in the what is it? Trade show budget already, that from things that we from things that we didn't do, and the little bit of extra other opportunity line that we put in there, because when things we don't know are going to pop up. Mm-hmm. So I think I don't really need any money from this. This is more because it has to go to the county commission, since it's unbudgeted travel, and especially since it's international. So I wanted to make sure that this board knew about it before we run it up the agenda items in the BOCC meeting.
You said you're 95% sure it's already in the budget?
I think I have the funds. I know in travel, the travel funds, I know I do, and I'm 95% sure there's enough without any extra funds, or I can move things from another category to cover the cost. So it's mostly awareness that we want to do it and we think it's a good idea, and also that it, so that you don't see it show up on the board agenda without any knowledge that it's coming forward.
Could I ask you a question? Mm-hmm. What was at our peak, what was our percentage of international travel, and what is it now?
I believe it was close to 20% was our peak. our best ever. Well, since everything went into the pod, it's COVID, probably zero. Yeah. You know, okay. or minimal, maybe not quite zero, but it's nowhere near where we were at the peak. But they, as you mentioned earlier about people spending money and things like that, what we found out when we were in London is that they haven't been anywhere. You know, they were very restrictive, right, on where they could go. Some of the citizens couldn't go to another sector to visit their family during the holidays because of the way their system ran. So they may not come in for any longer, but they're far more likely to spend more money because they have it. And so, you know, Germany is in the same boat.
Yeah, I mean, I asked that question to make the point that I think this is the best money we can spend. I mean, this is the area, yeah, to where we have the most potential to get the most visitors and the most money spent back.
Directly speaking to the folks that are speaking to the consumers to bring them here. That's, mm-hmm, you know, it's, yeah, definitely so the trade side.
I love it.
And it's not just Germany, too, if I might just add, yeah, it, and all of the EU markets.
So. Yeah. Yep.
So,
do you need a motion? Or?
I do.
I make a motion that we accept this recommendation on Brand USA.
Second.
All
right. Got a motion and a second.
Got
any
thing going here. Today.
Public or board discussion?
Good. I already put the registration in as a placeholder. We didn't spend any money. It didn't cost us anything, so I did it.
That's but, good thinking, though.
Yeah, because if we waited, we may not have got in.
Forgiveness is easier than permission, yeah, I guess. Yeah.
And well, there's no cost, spirit, of course.
Yeah, anything no cost, I'm probably going to put my name in there.
Right.
The spirit of transparency.
Just in case. All right. Those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Motion carries unanimously.
Who would be going?
Terry and I. We did a good tag team bit over there in London.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So the next one is really an informational item. It's the contract for the Star Tournament again. We would be in this 3-year deal. We would be the host again for the annual, meeting, the annual awards banquet on the 3rd year of the contract. The reason I brought it on this one is that it's significantly more on the 3rd year this time than it was this year when we hosted. It was 15 this year as the host. Next time it's 25. But that's a budget item and for 3 fiscal years from now. But mostly just wanted to make that aware that I do believe this is an excellent partnership to continue. Especially with the prizes they hand out if you catch the right fish, you spent your roughly $70 to participate, you can walk away with some huge prizes. So, yeah.
So the $15,000 is a misprint.
It's $15,000 the first 2 years, and then $25,000 for the 3rd year that we host. Correct.
22-23 distribution says $10,000 for 22-23 and 24, and $15,000 for 24.
Oh yeah, that must
be. So it's
25. It's 10 to continue our marketing partnership, and 15 for the to be the sponsor.
So total of 45.
Right. Yeah. Split over the 3 fiscals. Yeah. So the next two, the 23 and 24 are just like always, where, and then when we host it, there's a bigger bump. So that's more, you know, as we move forward with the contract, that's more of informational that on that side. So the next thing is the visitor guide draft. So we'll turn that over to Jody. She's got some good slides for you.
All right. So we discussed previously. Moving forward with the size reference really fast. Moving forward with the magazine, trying a different approach because we are hearing some feedback that for advertising and such that it may not be the best investment for our partners. And of course, we know just in general the world is moving towards digital. That march will continue on. And so this is our idea moving forward for the visitor guide. It would be similar to this size when folded. So this is kind of the opened up version. That would be the front cover and the back cover. And the reason the back cover is like that is so that we can actually directly mail the visitor guide as is, just write the address on the back there and stick the stamp on. So that way it's a little bit easier, a little bit saving on the postage cost, because we do have people that request it to be mailed out to them in general. So this would be about the size, so it's way easier, especially for like Terry when she's going to her trade shows, to carry around, to throw in your bag, something of that nature. The front cover, of course, will have a few options as far as one for manatees, one for cycling, one for scalloping. And then moving forward to the inside of the book, so this is again that opened up, folded out version. In an example of a few of the different layouts, this, we're not, you know, looking for any sort of approval as far as content goes. We're just trying to give you guys an idea, because we talked before about being very photo heavy and text light and redirecting them back to the website for additional information. So this is just a nice, beautiful little overview of the city of Inverness. And if they want, they can scan that QR code and it'll take them directly to a 3-day Inverness itinerary that has suggestions on all the activities you can do, restaurants you can eat at, and all of those itineraries I've already built out. So it really cuts down on the amount of staff time required to make the magazine, because of course you'd want something a little bit different every year, but instead, you know, we just have that short chunk of text, and then those itineraries can live on forever so long as they're relevant. Another example of layouts, this one is just the hotel and B&B side of it, and then we'd have a different one for the RV and campsites. So this is, I obviously was not typing out every single one of them, so a lot of them are copy-pasted, but this would be kind of the idea of what the listings would look like, and this is actually the exact number of hotels we currently have, so this would be a very good look at what it would look like. And so each one would have their own individual listing with websites, phone numbers, addresses, and then a little bit of a blurb there about staying in character-filled motels, one-of-a-kind B&Bs, waterfront resorts, things of that nature. And then they can scan, again, the QR code and be directed to the lodging page there on the website. Scalloping, just an example there, cute blurb. Back to the website for information on different captains and charters, cook your catch, things of that nature. Foodie favorites, so the different restaurants in the area. So having just, we like the idea, this is again showing you guys some of the different layouts that we like as well. So, you know, kind of switching between 5 to 6 different layouts throughout. That way it's not quite as labor intensive for us if we are making it in-house. But I love this example of being, you know, the Insta-worthy food locations, different places where you can go and enjoy a meal that you can post a beautiful picture of because people love it. And then of course, can't have the magazine without the manatees. And also highlighting there up at the top, Mind Your Manatee Manners. We're continuing that push towards, you know, that responsible ecotourism. And then they can scan there, watch the Manatee Manners video, as well as find the different tour operators there in the area. And yeah, that's up. So we just wanted your guys' thoughts as far as the directions that we're looking at. This is a very, you know, 10,000 foot view of it, a rough draft, something that I put together, you know, fairly quickly just for you guys to see some example of the views that we're looking at.
In my briefing prior to this with John, he said that this is rough, like done in Canva. This isn't this isn't the final design. I've done this
a few times.
Come, it's very weird being on the client side of things, I have to say, but I totally understand, and I think that this, from a functional standpoint, is an excellent way to go. But
it's a shift a little bit more from the magazine format that we've been doing to more of an inspiration guide that's so less heavy on the articles and more on the visual, which we have great assets on that.
That's Are we selling ads to it, trying to pay for it that way? None of that. We're just going to produce it as a yeah. inspiration
piece. The cost comes so correct. Low right. for okay. production yeah, purposes that it.
We are going to do, you know, Jody said we might, unless Jody goes away, we're probably going to do it in-house.
I'm getting fired, y'all.
No. I'm more worried about somebody seeing what you do.
Right. That office Randy's tends to attract attention.
Okay. To be honest, I'm Randy. I'm 0-2 so far.
Right. Randy left, you're fine.
Yeah.
But that's the fear is that somebody recognizes talent and... Yeah. So
the county thanks you for your service.
Yeah.
John finds them. You guys do.
Yeah, that's right. I'm doing all the hard work. I'm finding people. so that's the the idea. And the mailer type thing is something I did. We did in Gainesville. We switched to that smaller magazine and could fold it in half and mail it a lot easier. Mm-hmm. It may not be able to be folded in half as after we get done in terms of number of pages, but it's still it's going to just be a better thing all the way around, I believe. And next month we'll talk about how we're going to sell ads and something else. They're coming to do that.
Okay.
And currently for our magazine it's about 80 pages roundabouts. So our goal for the first year with this condensed visitor's guide version would be 40. So cutting that straight in half, but still having lots of available information.
I like it.
Any other questions?
So you go to 40 pages, you're showing 10 here. What other content's gonna be in the other 30 pages?
So, I mean, we have, this is like the Inverness itinerary. We have a full Citrus County one, we have a Crystal River one, we have a Homosassa
expansion
one, we have
on one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So anything that we have, we already have these web pages developed. We have tons of great blog posts right. about scalloping or cycling in the area. We have a motorcycle okay. itinerary available on our page, and all of these are already built out, so it's not any additional time on staff, and so it's great. We definitely have 40 pages worth of content. And so really it's just putting together a pretty picture format and a great little blurb.
The only other question I had, one of the thoughts with the magazine, I agree, go this direction for easy, user-friendly, but this may be as much or more of a Madden question. I thought one of the things that set us apart with the magazine was the articles and that content that was SEO-able and the content deliverable, which we seem to be going almost completely away from in this environment. And when I did a few QR codes, I know this is a rough thing. Do we have those articles resident on the website that could be queued in mm-hmm. as well if somebody actually wanted to read the article and mm-hmm. not just be shown a litany of here's tour operators to go swim with and here's hotels to stay and here's rest. But I want to read about the dining experience in the destination and the life day in the life of a golf ball.
Somebody's got
we really need to make one of those for Michael.
Yeah. I just my mom, when you're showing the 3D stuff, I'm like thinking of a golf ball flying in the hole, somebody picking it up, putting it in the basket. It's like he bounces around the cart until he gets.
Mine was just going to water.
It'll be a award-winning movie in the year 2500 or something.
So we have great blog content that is written by Miles, written by myself, right. not
great,
to say my own
horn.
And so what we do there is if we want to take, say, some of these previous articles that have already been in magazines in years past, we take those and readapt them to blog posts, and the QR code will link you there. But the great part about the blog post is that it says Manatee tour operators in that blog, and you
right.
click on that and it takes you
right,
to the
exactly.
listing. So whether we focus more on listings or more on articles, a good combination of both, that's totally up for us.
Yeah. Because I know that was what you guys built your world on from the original mm-hmm. concept was the content creation.
Yeah, so content creation, so we don't publish, we don't do
no,
those guys.
Not at
so
all.
content creation, though, is definitely moving, more and more online. We're doing similar guide tactics across the nation for the guides that we do publish, driving QR codes, to push online. Because you do get that SEO value, you can track those analytics. I will also say, I've had several guides within the last 2 years also switch from like an 8.5 by 11 size to a digest 5 by 7, and it's specifically a 40 page. That'll still be able to fold and do a saddle stitch binding, which is like the staple binding. So I don't foresee any issues with that, but I do think, again, kind of going back to your question of like, you know, are QR codes relevant? This just kind of, again, proves that like this is the direction that, you know, people are moving forward to across the nation.
No, that's good. I love the way we're the direction. I just was curious about the make sure we don't lose the traction on the content that's been so great.
Oh, absolutely. And for those that aren't familiar with QR codes, which thankfully, again, for COVID, we do have almost everybody at least knows how to use one. There's the phone number right there in the bottom left-hand side for the Tourism Information Center. If they see, oh my God, look how beautiful Inverness is, I want to learn more, I want to book, and they're not comfortable online, they just give us a call, and we've got beautiful Kelly who can direct them to whatever they need to do, give them a phone number, anything like that, or if they'd rather just go to the website themselves, that's open and available too. So we're trying to provide as many different avenues, but definitely that QR code is the quickest, easiest method to take you exactly where you want to be. And for most people, definitely not some of the older generation, of course.
They're coming around, some of them.
Yay!
They'll be gone soon.
Wow.
You know,
nobody gets out alive.
That's something I would have said.
Not, but in the meantime, we need to make sure they leave all their money with us before they go.
Yes.
Any other questions, concerns?
The one other thing I would say, too, going back to your thing about listings, that is also a huge, huge trend of listings are going away. It takes up so much valuable real estate space in your pages. Printing cost alone over the last 2 years have increased almost 60%. There are only a handful of paper mills in the U.S., and they are all either at max capacity or because of union standards, they have been on protest, and even some of them have shut down.
Yeah,
so paper costs are just astronomical right now. So, you know, condensing down is smart. We're moving listings. When people are talking about listings, potentially the hotel listings are the only ones that we see that are staying in there because, of course, you get your accommodations tax, drop heads and beds, right? So the hotel partners are staying, but then all the other listings are being pulled out to be driven online. Because also, too, like you don't want to take a guide, you know, 11 months after it's published and 10 of the businesses are closed down, right, or the, you know, something has changed. So having that online presence, especially for the listings, makes it much, much more valuable online.
I have another question for you, TJ.
Okay. Yes.
So I just ran a quick search and I couldn't find the answer to this. I know that the search popped up that custom stamps have been canceled by the U.S. Postal Service. You can't do that anymore. But going way back, didn't they used to have a particular post office could get the cancellation stamp that they put on over the, you know, the cancellation thing when it runs through the mail? The stamp is canceled, that ink thing. Could we not have, I mean, do they still do custom ones through the U.S. Postal Service?
That's a question I would have to get back to.
Because it'd be really interesting if the Crystal River Post Office would cancel all the mail coming out of Crystal River with the manatee capital of the world insignia or the shape of a manatee or something like that.
I'm definitely
dating myself as an old person because that
it's
used
a good
to
idea
be
to pull that off, though.
That's something that we could check into. I will say, just guessing that the price for that would be pretty astronomical. Another option would be if you would want to poly bag your guides, but again, that there's an additional price for that. Because with the poly bags, you could have like a design, you know, manatee sleeve or something on that bag.
Well, I'm talking about all mail leaving.
Well,
all mail.
Let me get on the phone with the Postmaster General. I'll get back to you.
I'm just curious if
they
even
fired
exist.
Him. I think he's getting run off.
Hey, yeah, we're supposed to be like a big. Yeah. Yeah. But I mean, that's a way that, you know, that's a one-time whatever thing. I mean, they used to do it. I swear, they used to do it. So maybe they don't.
I don't know that one.
I swear.
My environmental soul says no to poly mail.
I know. I was thinking the same.
It hurts.
We're just doing big conservation. TJ, bite your tongue.
There you go. That's nice. But biocompostable or in a facility? Sorry. I digress. Anyway, any other questions, concerns, comments? We just want to know that you guys like the direction that we're heading before I start putting my nose to the grind and actually working to develop something that we can show you
a tangible example of, if you will.
We like you.
We like it.
I do too.
Good
job. First, but I do now.
Thank you. This is a lot easier than last.
Right, jump out the window. You got a yes.
John, you better treat her well.
Working on it.
And
you let me get a treadmill to put under my stand-up desk, so I'm not going anywhere.
Nice.
That was her
literally
request.
Not
I did
going
not.
Literally.
I did not just put one under her desk. That was. She asked, "Could she have one?"
Good
so,
choice.
Yeah, I don't want one.
Before we get into all the numbers, so our river cam got struck by lightning. The one at McRae's. Yes. So they're working on a quote for replacing that, and we'll have to come back with that. Maybe. I don't know what it's going to cost. It might be something we can, like I said, we can absorb within the budget. But so if you hear, you know, we're not seeing the river cam, well, it's currently an ICU.
Just send them over to ours.
Right. It's on the same page. So we still have a camera
a
working.
River cam.
So. But yeah, I just wanted to let you know on that. So numbers-wise, as you can see, some of these were in the paper this week. You know, a banner month in terms of occupancy and ADR, as we're, it seems like things are, I keep saying it's not sustainable, but I'm happy to be wrong on this one. It's because it each month continues to be better than the last. There you go. So year to date, you know, we're up almost 14%. We're a little bit better than 14%, which is pretty. You know, that's pretty amazing. But and you can see across the board, you know, our other competitive set are having a, you know, the same level of success. So that's a good sign. Money wise, you know, this is where I keep saying that I'm keeps up. I'm it's like, okay, maybe I'm wrong. It's great.
Oh,
I'm great that I'm wrong on this one.
Kind of eye-popping.
Yes. So everybody remember how strong last year was, and we're already almost 29% ahead of last year's revenue totals.
Yeah.
So
when I looked at the table, that the other table you have
mm-hmm.
by year.
Yeah.
How'd you come up with 29%? Because my eyeballing it says it should be 40-42%, because every single month was above 28% except one.
So
I used
Excel. So I hope I have the formula right.
You look at the revenue chart.
Yeah. So I'm looking at this chart.
Right. So
and when you scan the months, it's by month 23, 39, 45, 52, 41, with an average of 28. And it's our lowest month is the 23. So my eyeballing it says we're up at 41-42%.
Well, so this the revenue numbers there represent the first five checks that we've received.
Right.
And so I did the math of so it's new year minus old year divided by old year.
Right.
And so that comes out to be 300, you know, 306,000 is the difference between the two, and 28.7 is the increase between total collection.
Now, I think you did it over new year, not old year, maybe, because the old year is only about 700,000. So 306 over 1,065,000 would be your 28, 29.
Right.
But it really should be the 306 over the first five of the 2021, about 700K. It should be about 40%. Right, Mike? I'm the stat person. He's the math person.
He's the math guru.
I'm doing it now.
Is it? Okay. it's very likely that I put the wrong numbers, but they're the right numbers in the wrong order.
40.4%.
Okay.
Okay.
So that's
I was
even better. Okay.
41,
yeah.
So.
Like I said, I thought
it's
I had
even
it right.
Better.
Yeah.
Woo-hoo.
So look. Yeah. It was a conservative estimate. Yeah. Right. That's right. I just. Yeah. So then we look like a hero when we true up again because I've been telling you so much less.
I was gonna say. Yeah. You're just
it's all a big plan.
For more money.
It's all a big plan.
Okay.
I'll go back and fix
Jeez,
it and make sure it. So. But yeah, I guess I just had the wrong order. I appreciate that. Like I said, I
just can figure out how you got there for sure.
I got there because I used the wrong numbers. But it's still a win, so we'll go with that. But yeah, I'll have that fixed for the next month. And then now we're back to Jody with the Instagram.
So I'd like, if we could start at the Insta page. Fun little tidbit. Makes me very happy and very sad all at the same time. We had, I posted a scalloping video that I took last year during scalloping season. It did well on our page, but a different page based out of Sarasota, they did tag us, but they took it and posted it on theirs, and it went viral. So it's got well over a million likes at this point. So I'll show you ours, which is the long format, and then we'll show you theirs as well. And I'll tell you my plan moving forward as far as how that goes. Go ahead. You might have to click the sound. That sound is important. The scallop dances to Weezer, basically is the whole gist of it. And you'll see it whenever it restarts. But this is just a kind of a compilation of myself scalloping, as well as some of the Madden footage that we have from the past of different scalloping days. So, like, the kids are not mine. I don't have any of those.
That's really it.
But once it,
That's awesome.
So, cute, adorable. My best guesstimate as to why ours, because the page that did post it, and Christine, if you want to pull that up, you can. They were a very no-name, 251 followers. Now they're up to 3,000. They're welcome. but it, I would say they did a short format of it, and when you do something that's going to have go viral, it's probably going to be something geared towards your late teens, early 20s. We figured out that the late teens, early 20s do not like it when they figure out you eat the scallops. So the short format worked really well for them in that, if you want to play it. And you can see there, 1 million. And so they just did the first beginning part of it there. And they have, you know, 30-some thousand comments on it. And you see us right there at the top posted. Now, granted, those responses are not all necessarily positive, because that's, again, when they figured out that you eat them. And they're a little worried about that, but they don't know what's going on. So
you eat them before they die of natural causes.
Yes. And that would be, if you look under the comments, I did respond to several of them, letting them know that they only have a one-year lifespan, and FWC, make sure that we're not affecting any sort of future generations. We actually have the healthiest seagrass beds in the world, and that's the reason why these scallops can thrive the way that they do.
Wait, is that virtual reality there?
No, but if you want to pay me $186,000, I can make it. And so but that was a great success for us in that regard of there's been at least 60 different accounts that have taken it, reposted it, and tagged us in it. And so part of that leads to my future good news later on, so if you want to go back to the slides there. But it's fun to have a viral video, even if it's not on our page.
That's
cool. It's fine. Everything's fine. Mm-hmm. So here you can see our top posts on Instagram from that time for last month. And so we did a great post of this aggregation of manatees, but utilized a comment down below what you think a group of manatees is called. And we got really great answers, one of them being a cuddle puddle, which you see at the top there. And I was actually able to use that for our April Fool's Day post. So I'm not sure if any of you saw that, but our April Fool's Day post was a different photo of a group of manatees. And it's talked about how mixed in the arduous Florida tax bill was the proposal to change the name of a group of manatees from an aggregation to a cuddle puddle, and how excited we are about it, yada, 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 April Fools. And that did really well also. And this one is up to almost 3,000 likes itself, but it's just a great shot there. And then as far as the reels, let's see, sometimes it plays it for us, sometimes it does not. There we go. This was taken by one of our fam tours
over there at the wildlife park at the Fish Bowl in Homosassa, and it was just a really awesome shot of those fish swirling. There's actually a manatee in the shot too, if you look really closely. So that was a fun reel that people really enjoyed. And I'm happy to say that Instagram followers is actually up to 25,000 now of today. On to the next one. All right. So for the Facebook main page, this was an adorable video of a manatee coming up and booping the camera. Those always do very well. We're inching closer and closer to that 200,000 follower mark there on the Facebook page. And I'll always say Facebook's a little bit harder to get the traction with, so any movement is good movement, in my opinion. And Katie Jo is continuing to kill it when it comes to her fishing reports. People absolutely love them, so we'll continue to move forward with those. And a little update to this, thanks to our fun scalloping video, we have passed both New Smyrna Beach and Amelia Island. Ooh. So. Yeah.
For the record, it is non-alcohol. Not on county property.
So very excited for that. I, you know, obviously that's been a goal of mine for quite a while now. So I'm super happy about that one.
I don't know why. I honestly do not know why I have Jell-O cup shots in my, rather than actual adult glasses. I think I made a dessert pre-COVID that went in the little cups. I don't know.
It's like dishwater.
That is adorable.
I am not Josh Wooten. I literally do not.
That was awesome.
I love it.
Good job, Booty.
Thank you for that.
Would have liked to see another commissioner do that.
Woo. I'm sorry?
Our previous commissioner wouldn't have done
that. I don't know that.
For our stats for February to March.
But at least he always showed up on time. That was a little time management problem.
Everybody's got their pros and cons. On Instagram, we gained almost 400 new followers. And right now, currently, we're gaining about 100 new ones a day. So that should be fun whenever we look at next month's. One thing that I'm always striving for is an increase in non-follower interaction, because those are going to be our potential new visitors. So we got a 28.6% increase in non-follower interaction. And then I'm continuing the method of the link in bio. So you can't do a link in an Instagram caption, but you can add it to your bio and have, thank you. have people click through that way. And so we're still continuing to see success directing people to the bio to click through over to the website. For Facebook, 366 new followers. And I told you before that we needed to keep an eye on our video views for the fishing page, because Mike Anderson is doing those tackle tips. And now, granted, if you look at the numbers versus the percentage, it kind of evens out a little. But over 1,000% increase in those video views. 652 total, so nothing actually all that crazy, but still something that we can continue to improve upon. And we're really almost adjusting that audience to video content, because they're so used to that written content over there on that page.
So congratulations, everybody has it now. Good job.
Thank
to
you.
All of, to all of the staff.
Yeah, to a toast to our staff, I like
thank
that.
You.
Thank you, guys.
It's better than their alcohol-free wine.
And
it's kind of like grape juice.
Yeah.
With bubbles.
Love it. About 830,000 total accounts reached on Facebook during that month. For our fam tours coming up, lots and lots of German fams. So like you were saying, with the potential there coming up, they're very excited. We had Terry did her Canusa one, which was 15 tour operators, right? Yep. That was a great opportunity. And then I had those two German journalists. One of them, Audio Travels, is actually a podcast, which wasn't something that we've had experience with in the past. So that was an exciting new platform to utilize. And so there's a few different options coming up, and we're actually Brittany with Hayworth and I are in talks with a few different TikTok influencers as well, so that'll be something exciting as far as fam tours go moving forward, since we can't have our own TikTok yet. We'll just use other people's.
Nice.
So some of those deliverables there on the you and Cohen fam tour. Christine, if you could click the video one. I think it's a link. Yeah. I have to turn that up. Down the coast, from the
beaches to the valleys. Your news channel starts right now.
Well, are you booking that vacation for the fall? Well, if you need some inspiration, we have the right person joining us live today.
Author of the 30-Day Travel Challenge, Kyla Yu, back with us here on News Channel 11. Good morning, Kyla. Where are we headed today?
Hey, how are you guys? We're headed to Crystal River, which is a charming little town just north of Tampa. And it's famous because it's the only place in North America that you could legally sleep. I mean, not sleep, swim with manatees.
You don't want to sleep with the manatees. Yeah, that's a whole other show.
Yeah. Manatees are starving elsewhere in Florida, but they are thriving here in Crystal River.
And we're seeing some cool video of, I guess, a place to stay in Crystal River. Oh, where do you suggest?
You should stay at the Plantation at Crystal River because it's charming and it's southern hospitality. But most importantly, they have a dock with a boat with manatees just 5 minutes away. And they have everything you need, wetsuits and masks and snorkel, and you could jump in with the manatees right from the hotel.
That sounds absolutely amazing.
Let's talk about those manatees. When you go do this, what's it like? And you've done this before.
Yes, I'm obsessed with manatees. I think I've mentioned them before. And swimming with these gentle creatures is so magical. They're so sweet and they're slow. And you're not allowed to touch the manatees, but they're allowed to touch you. Mm. And they do. They're friendly. They'll come up and kind of bop you. And I saw like probably 500 of them. It was quite a lot. Most of them were sleeping.
There you are.
Is that you? Oh, wow.
A lot of them came up to play.
Oh, they're so cool.
What a great idea. I would have never known about this. I love that. I'm going to do this.
And if you're not into under the water activities, there are some above water activities too, right?
Definitely. So when you're visiting Florida, you should go on an airboat ride. You got to travel to the next city over, Homosassa, which is just 20 minutes away. And the airboat ride is so fun because the boat has no propellers underneath. So it just glides over the water and it could take you to these like shallow parts of the lagoon that other boats can't reach. And it's thrilling and it's really fast and it's a total adventure.
All right. Hey, spring break's coming up, so go hang out with the manatees.
Don't sleep with them.
Kyla Yu, the 30-day travel expert, thanks so much for joining us. We'll talk to you again soon.
Thank you, you guys.
Well, that was super fun.
Sorry.
I'm hooking that.
She tried her best to reel them in, but those
that's
anchors were
for sure.
Sticking
for
their
sure.
hands on that one. So we could switch back to the slides there. And so Kyla came with a friend, Aaron Cohen, whose boyfriend did all the drone footage and stuff that you saw in some of Kyla's coverage as well. But Aaron was doing an ad for Citibank, like their travel card. And so she actually roped Crystal River into that advertisement for that card. So that was, an additional benefit that we didn't pay anything for. And it should play, but you want to click that one and see if it works for you? Yeah. some of the deliverables that came out of that particular trip. And Michael, lots of great things for you there. We're both pushing buttons. All right, Michael. We had Bill Vanderford in as well, and he is a photographer and journalist out of Atlanta, and he shared with us some of the photos that he took while he was here. One thing that I loved was that he was able to attend Fort Cooper Day, so that was a great thing for over there on the east side as well. And then the Their Life, My Lens with Chasten. So she did several different stories as well as a few posts centered around their time filming here. And so one of them, that one there in the middle, is great because it is, she obviously works with special needs children. And so she was able to, John and Terry worked with her to get them in at the pizza joint over there, that tiny little hole in the wall place, where they were able to make their own pies. And so it was a really great experience, and she documented all that on her story with them. And that'd be it for me. Any questions or anything for that one?
Great job.
Thanks,
guys. Yeah, very good.
Good.
Oh,
do I have to go
up? No, you don't have to. Oh, you want the clicker?
Nope. Go ahead.
Thanks. Yep, there it is. Sales. Kind of all the same. Yep, just sales stuff. Met with Gosh and Lieb to talk about next year's budgets and what we're going to do with them. I already did the Canusa fam, and it was very successful, although they were here less than 24 hours. I continued on with some follow-up appointments, and actually have done a couple of virtual trainings with some of the people that I met with at Huddle in January. And I've got a couple of pre and post IPW. IPW is a show I'm going to in Orlando that Brand USA does. It's in June. And I'm working with some of our, like Tampa, Clearwater, St. Pete, on some joint FAMs there. Worked with EDC for that site inspection thing that we had, and numerous other tasks, phone calls regarding sales and marketing. There you go. I know we're running late, so I'll keep it short and sweet.
Yeah. I need to learn that.
That's good work too, though. Just because it's short and sweet, that's great. We appreciate it.
Okay.
Next.
That's the end of the report.
All right. The only thing that I wanted to bring up, and since we don't have our city council members here, is it came up in the strategic planning session, a question as to why we don't have weekend coverage at the information center, the tourism visitor center. Thank you.
I don't have an answer for that at this moment. It's something we could look into in terms of how to shift the resources. We have talked about it a little bit, but hadn't gone any farther than that.
Do we have volunteers? Do we as a unit have volunteers?
No, not currently.
Okay, might be. I mean,
yeah.
I know that's got its own set of issues, but.
Right.
Seems like we should probably look into that.
Miles is stumbling toward the podium.
Sure.
You're public.
Open to the now public.
We actually, We actually did it maybe 3 years ago. We did an experiment for 3 months. And we would get about, the best day we ever had was 7 visitors.
Oh, wow.
And usually we were getting 1 to 3 on those days. So it's not to say that if you did it permanently, you wouldn't have better results.
Right.
But we did it during scallop season. So it could be that everybody was out scalloping and they didn't have any time to be at our visitor center. It could have been that.
Good feedback.
What is a normal traffic during the week?
Probably Kelly could tell us on a normal day we get quite a few people through.
Yeah, I mean, I've only been there since the end of January, but I mean, I guess it depends where you come from, but I don't think it's been too busy. I think a lot of it has to do with the construction on 19. Mm-hmm. Now they have that barrier up and they can't even turn directly in. You have to do all sorts of U-turns around to get to and from our office.
Maybe we should try it again after 19 is finished in
2028. Yeah. You're optimistic. Wow. You're optimistic.
Would y'all like to see my email box about that subject?
No. I have something if you're finish.
Yes, I'm done.
This is really for JT.
TJ.
TJ, JT, I'm dyslexic.
I answer by pretty much anything.
Right, I got you. Our market manager. Our manatees are alive and well and thriving, and on the East Coast, that is not the case. So the legislature spent millions to address that problem, and it's not going to address the problem. You know, they did lettuce feeding at the Florida Power and Light. They've cut that off. Those poor manatees are just going to starve a little more slowly. They're going to have to do on the East Coast what we've done over here, years and years of replanting the eelgrass before it comes back, and it's a sad situation. But I don't know if there's a way to say that our manatees are fine, come here, not the other side, if you want to see manatees. I don't know how you do that tactfully. But it's like red tide. Once, you know, someone in New Hampshire hears red tide in Florida, it's all over Florida. And the manatees are starving. They're starving everywhere in Florida. So if there's a way in our marketing to put some kind of point on that, I think it would be helpful.
Okay, yeah, we could definitely keep that in mind.
You know, because this isn't going away. I mean, it's going to be years they're going to starve over there. So.
I think we had talked about that when you were off earning your paycheck in Tallahassee.
Feeding the baby in Tallahassee. Yeah.
Any other business?
Yeah, two quick things. It popped into my mind as far as locations. Would it make sense if we move forward with virtual reality, et cetera, to put something down at Tico at Apollo Beach where people are going there to see the manatees and it's a, oh, by the way, drive an hour north, you can swim with them.
Great idea.
Yeah, so just a spitball there as well.
Yeah, that would be something. We would probably coordinate that because there's really nobody to talk to there, I would think. But we could, you know, certainly put Jody in a manatee costume and I could stand there with the phone.
We'll borrow the chambers.
That's a great idea, though, Mike. I mean, they're pretty much in destination almost at that point. Might as well be, right?
Yep, and you're seeing them in the wild. You can swim with them.
Yeah, that's great.
And the other thing as far as sleeping with the manatees, I had a fam group come in. It's going to be on British CBS coming up in a couple weeks, and she finishes the thing, gets the ladder of the boat, and her, so what'd you think, Jane? Oh, I've never seen manta rays in the wild before. We're like, take two.
That's awesome.
Do you know when that's when it's gonna air?
It's holidaying with Jane McDonald. It's four. There's four segments per episode. There's four episodes. It's going to be end of April, into May. I'm not sure which episode we'll be in.
Okay. When you find out, will you let us know? And we'll be happy to share that. Thank you.
Okay. Anything else? Be looking for a motion to put Jean McGee in the manatee costume instead of Jody? Anyone?
I don't think it'll fit me. I'm not tall enough.
Yeah. We love you, Jane.
I heard that died for lack of emotion. I don't know.
Would anybody like?
Thank you.
Anybody in our audience like to address us? Okay, then I think we're good. All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.